gotta get your swagger together, nigga. Get your suitcase. Stars on the inside, you dig?
I don't need mine. I got cribs when we go.
You don't love yourself, you can't love nobody.
Keep up, nigga.
Okay. I love myself.
You gonna do it, nigga. You gonna goddamn make these.
I'm the man from Atlanta, so where I'm Cali. Get me in New York, I'm on the way to Miami.
Atlantic is an account.
I be at home barely. I sleep when I'm buried. What I need to sleep for, it don't got me eat.
What's going on? It's Deepcovertv. It's your host, BD. We are live right now at WPB Networks. They meet with Mr. Frank Jones. Hold on, let me introduce him the right way. Executive entertainer. Media mogul. The man got so many hats, so many names you can label him. I don't know what to call him, but I'm gonna tell you this, it's going down. Let's go check this out.
Alright man, so we're gonna go ahead and jump right into this interview. It's a pleasure to have you here right now, FRANKE Johnson. Let me know when you're ready. You ready?
Right. Nah, just give me two chicken and waffles. I'm joking.
And so I guess that kind of gets to my first question is, who was FRANKE Jones? A comedian.
No, I'm definitely not a comedian. I'm no Larry Lancaster. But I think FRANKE Johnson is a, wow, that's an interesting question. A father. Husband, an aspiring executive, a person who just believed that when, if you can think it, you can do it.
Right.
You know, most of my life I've just always had the, I guess, the aspiration to do whatever I wanted to do, and for me it's always just been about doing it, seeing if I can do it, challenging myself to speak it and then make it happen. So, you know, I'm a 25-year entertainment exec, and some people, a lot of people use that very loosely, and, you know, but I'm an actual entertainment exec. I was Def Jam, I think, was 8 years, probably 9 years at Def Jam, a regional marketing manager, promoted to a national director of Mix Show. Left there, went to Atlantic Records, was there for about 7 years or so as national
with Atlantic Records?
National lifestyle. Atlantic is an account of mine now.
Okay.
So probably about 5 years ago, I decided to resign from Atlantic Records. I came back to Baltimore, and I saw my daughters growing. They're currently 12 and 14 now, and at the time they were, it was about 5 years ago, so they were around 8 and 9-ish, so they're babies.
Right.
So, you know, I decided to move back home, and, you know, with the blessings of a very good friend and mentor of mine, Kevin Lyles. I don't know if you ever heard of Kevin Lyles, but, you know, he said, if that's what you want to do, I want you to do it on one accord, is that you go back to Baltimore and put on for your city. So I decided to relocate back to Baltimore. I retained my account working for Atlantic Records and other labels as a consultant. And I decided to open a venue, a vehicle for people to be able to do media and entertainment and so forth. So I would also say I'm a philanthropist. It's many things. It's hard to say what I am.
So what made you get into all that, being in the entertainment world?
Ooh, okay, now you ask. You want the short story or the long story? No, probably when I was a lot younger, when I was probably around about 10, maybe 12, 13, 14, maybe 15, maybe. My younger brother was very much into music. And he woke up one morning and he heard this group named Run DMC that was on the air. You ever heard of Run DMC? I just want to gotta ask these questions. You'd be surprised how many artists I ask about other artists and they don't know who they are.
Hey, I'm,
but in any instance, he heard Run DMC. It's like that on the radio, and he was like, "Yo, I want to be Run DMC." So he couldn't be Run DMC without another person. So he recruited me. Thus started my rap career. And you know, I ventured and I continued to drive, and you know, it sparked my interest. That's when music sparked my interest, because I was never into music at all. And he decided to go on and continue playing basketball, God rest his soul. And I decided to stay into music, and ever since then I've been into music. I've ventured into as an artist. I've made records that you could Google right now. I've been a commercial artist. I'm doing commercial advertisement for retail stores from across the country, including New York City. Left there, I relocated to New York. Well, 98.7 KISS relocated me to New York, which was the number one station in the country at the time. And then I got into producing. I met Teddy Riley, and he taught me how to work a drum machine, how to work, you know, play music. So that really funneled my creative drive to become a producer. Although I was producing then, but not to the degree that, you know, amazing talent like Teddy Riley sit there and take the time out to teach you how to work some equipment. You know, he was making loads of money, and they were good old days. I miss those days. And that's how I got into the music.
So how many people do you feel that you inspired, mentored people along the way?
I think I was inspired, you know, one way or another. You know, I get so many different variations of that. You know, some people saying, "Frank, you are a real asshole, but you taught me a lot." And some people just from the kind words and, you know, the guidance I give them, they just, you know, they've moved on to be very professional and successful people in their right. So, you know, and just to say that, and I had to give both sides of that coin, because, you know, sometimes when you go to work for people, it's almost like, you know, some people like, yo, my boss is this, my boss is that. But different people deliver things different ways. And me, I'm very passionate. I'm the type of person that, really, if I ask you to do something, I already did it. I'm just asking you because you said you wanted to do it, and I want to give you the chance to do it yourself. So 9 times out of 10, when I ask somebody to do something, I've done it. You know, it's there are days when I come in my office, and a lot of days when I come in my office, and it's nobody in my office but me. And people say, Kevin Lyles always say, "Frank, you don't work smart. You don't work smart at all." I say, "Why you say I don't work smart, Kevin?" He says, "Because there's so many people out there that just want to help, and you don't give them a chance to help because you do it yourself." And you know, that may be true, but you know, I'm just comfortable with getting it done.
You prefer just to work by yourself?
I actually don't. You know what? I would prefer to have my office packed. 888-400-1784. 888-400-1784. I would prefer to have my office packed with interns and motivated and aspiring people. I mean, we just invested into TV camera equipment. I have 3 radio stations in here. Open space for developing almost any kind of content and media that you want. And I designed this place under one of my mentors, and I like to call him one of my best friends, who inspired me to give back to other people because he gave to me, because people gave to him. And I think that, you know, we owe that to our community, especially right. In the African American community. We owe it to each other to really lend a ear and lend support and teach.
Try to help each other, build each other up.
Exactly, absolutely.
So what do you do as a record industry executive?
As a record industry executive, I promote records. some of my responsibilities are getting records played on the air, airwaves, or creating a way to get those records put on the airwaves, marketing and strategic strategies behind, you know, regionalized campaigns to promote artists, which means if I'm trying to work a Raheem Devon record, then I got to figure out, if I can't get the record on radio, I need to figure out some things to help get the record on radio, whether it's connecting the dot with social media, getting them on different websites like Flywire or Open Fly Magazine, you know, or different platforms to help elevate the records.
I see you're a very busy man. So what is an everyday life for Frank Johnson? What do you do every day? You get any sleep?
I get to sleep. Listen, I get up probably about 7 in the morning, take my kids, my daughter to school, take both my kids to school, and then I head out to the office. I'm usually in the office probably about 9:30, and then I'm on the phone trying to get records played, on the phone trying to get production set up for our TV show, which is Keeping It Real TV on My 24, trying to keep WPB Radio and WPB Networks running because we have 3 radio stations in here. You know, just a lot of coordinating and making moves.
Okay. So what drives you? What is your source of reason for your success?
I ultimately want to leave something, you know, in the Jewish communities and in a lot of other communities outside of the African-American communities, we build things to leave for our kids. Well, they build things to leave for their kids.
We don't
build things to leave for our, not saying all, but we for the most part as a community don't build businesses to leave to our children. We build businesses to eat today, and once we die, you don't really care what happens to it. So I want to build something monumental for Baltimore specifically, that creates jobs and opportunities for other peoples, and to be able to create a company that, you know, deliver amazing content. That's what I want to do.
So what do you feel as though, what is your biggest accomplishment so far?
My biggest accomplishment so far, raising 2 amazing daughters.
Yeah, that's it. I got a kid myself, so I know raising one is amazing.
Two amazing daughters. If I could say a second thing, is just being very vigilant and diligent and being able to visualize it and do it. You know, everything, and I got to say thanks and all glory to God, is that everything I've ever asked for, literally, I have. I've had 6 figures. I've probably made a couple of million in my lifetime. I've said I wanted it and manifested it because I believed it. And I think those are my accomplishments. It's always an accomplishment when you can dream something, want it, and then acquire it.
I see you with a lot of artists in the industry. So what people that we might know that you can name that you work with, that you enjoy working with at the same time?
I love working with T.I. Young Jeezy is the man. He's so cool. artists or just people in general?
People in general.
B.O.B., I like to call him one of my good friends. Amazing guy. Mariah Carey was a jewel to work with. Rihanna was amazing to work with because she's so fun. Wow. Jay-Z was probably one of the most interesting people to work for. And I worked for him as his national mix show at Def Jam when he was president. But he was a very interesting guy for the fact that I wish I could be around him a little longer, because it was amazing just to see how his thought process worked. Very strategic.
When you think outside the box.
Just, it's almost like it's contemplated. Everything is contemplated already. It's almost like it's all designed. He already have a design what he want to get done. No matter what your agenda is, he already has his design to what he want to get done. And obviously, he's very successful with it.
Do you think Baltimore would have that one major artist that would actually become global and get out there?
We have. Drew Hill.
Right. Maybe I should have said rap artists.
Rap artists. Do I ever think, you know what's interesting? There was a guy out here by the name of Tony Austin who was well on his way. You ever heard of Tony Austin?
Yeah, he owned the 2 O'Clock Club.
Right. But he was also an A&R for Def Jam time and Russell Simmons Music Group. But he it's funny that I say that, and I know people are going to be like, Tony Austin? But he was actually well on his way before, you know, an unfortunate incident happened to him. but do I think we'll ever have one? I pray so. Baltimore artists, I just got to say, you got to be humble. You have to really want it, and you have to go get it. Get out of these studios, man. Get out of just posting stuff on Facebook. Get out of just putting this stuff on YouTube. Get out. There's a whole world outside of Baltimore. As a matter of fact, in Baltimore, there's a whole world in Baltimore. And if you just get out and go win over a fan by fan, I guarantee you we'll have a major artist out of Baltimore. But we're so stuck on ourselves that we don't even ever leave the studio. Where in the studio? I mean, where you at? I'm in the studio. Yo, where you at? I'm in the studio, Dunn. Okay, oh, it's Friday. We're going to pop bottles. Okay, so what work did you actually get done outside of in the studio?
Do you think guys like Scooter and Moose break any barrels?
I think guys like Scooter and Moose prove that social media is very valuable in an artist's career. And that, you know, that tool helped them excel. But they also... I don't really know Moose and Scooter like that, so I can't tell what work they put in and what work they didn't put in.
Right.
But obviously, the YouTube phenomenon really helped excel their careers. And very importantly, even more importantly than that, is that it goes to prove that real people accept real music, because everything that Scooter and Moose talk about is things they've lived.
Exactly.
Not trying to be like Rick Ross or Jay-Z. They talk about what they live, and the people gravitated to it. And if more artists do that, instead of trying to be ballers, everybody want to pop bottles, everybody want to have a Benz or a Maybach. If you just stick true to what you know and it's believable, the fans are going to believe it. Because trust me, the fans know when you're bullcrapping them. I had to fix that one. You like the edit on the fly, right?
Now, I forgot to ask you. I know we in Baltimore. We've been talking Baltimore the whole time, the whole conversation. Mm-hmm. Now, are you originally from Baltimore?
I'm from Baltimore. Born and raised. West Baltimore.
West Baltimore.
2500 block Loretta Avenue, where my mom still lives. The street is now named Frank Johnson's Way.
Sure?
Yes.
That's interesting.
Yep. 2500 block Loretta Avenue. Drive to it and you'll see my sign up on the street. Frank Johnson's Way.
She bought the street?
No, I didn't buy it. The city of Baltimore dedicated it to me for all of the work I do. I do a lot of community work for the city. I'm so into giving back to the communities and giving back to our kids, especially to places where they never get to go to a concert, they never get to see a performance. No one ever really gives them anything.
So what ways do you give back to the communities? I know you said the concert, stuff like that.
I just try to be a part of the community any way I can. If there's a toy drive going on, I support it. Literally help to raise for it. If, you know, during the summer when all of these events are going on and people that can't really afford to have people, you know, I just help as much as possible. I just try to lend my support and lend my hand to as many ways as I can. You know, mentoring people as well.
So what's next for Frank Johnson?
Well, next I hope to someday follow, and no, I'm not going to say follow in the footsteps, but be able to be as successful as companies like Radio One,
okay.
Companies like Oprah Winfrey and Russell Simmons, and you know, my biggest aspiration is to be as successful as one of Baltimore's own Kevin Lyles.
So anything you want to say to the people before we get out of here?
Sitting in the studio, not connecting with your fans, won't make you a star. The playing field has leveled, and you can be Jay-Z, you can be Rihanna, you can be whoever you want to be. But you really have to put your mind to it, and it sounds like a cliche, but you really have to not only put your mind to it, but you have to get out there and shake hands and kiss babies. That's how President Barack Obama became president. That's how Kevin Lyles became president. All of these people are presidents. That's how Russell Simmons owned his own company and is such a major player in the world now, not just in music. But you can't just talk about it. You have to go out and be about it. Embrace your fan base. The social media and the internet has made it so simple right now for you to be anything you want to be. Utilize the tools that are out there and educate yourself.
It's your boy BD. It's Deepcovertv. I just got the exclusive interview with Mr. Frank Johnson. And just like that, we is out. Peace.
Say it loud. I'm
black and I'm proud.
What up, y'all? It's your boy Frank Johnson. I guess they call me an executive, a meteor, something, whatever. But any instance, Deepcovertv. Keep it live. Keep it live.
We got Deepcover up in the building. We're gonna get a few people to grab the mic.
I sleep when I'm buried. What I need some sleep for?
Yo, shout out to Deepcovertv, WPB Networks.